David Hayter is a talented actor, voice actor, and screenwriter for movies such as X-Men, X-Men 2, as well as co-writer for The Scorpion King and Watchmen. He's well known by gamers as the voice of Solid Snake in Metal Gear 1 through 4, Super Smash Bros. Brawl, and many other spin-off games. Please welcome David Hayter.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here on Classically Trained.
Well, thank you, sir. I am very interested in sharing ideas and concepts and lessons that we can learn from video games and the gaming industry, and I like to explore this intersection of professional world and gaming. So with that in mind, would you be able to share with us what is a lesson or idea that you've learned from video games?
Well, I mean, I play a fair amount of video games, so I would think that from some of the better written titles, I've learned a lot of things. That's Hollywood calling. I learned that in Oddworld, you want to be right up to the ledge before you jump, or you will be destroyed by some horrible mutant crab creature. So that served me well in life. Figure out the rules, you know. The first Tomb Raider was the same way. You had to, like, jump, you know, start your jump two blocks before the cliff, and then you would make it across. So, you know, be aware of the rules of the game, I think, was an important rule that I picked up. But, you know, look, if you look at something as complex as, you know, Grand Theft Auto or Metal Gear, you get all sorts of lessons. And in fact, in Metal Gear, you get way more lessons than you probably ever wanted in your life. You know, how to deal with Russian nuclear material, how to properly tranquilize somebody, you know, how to properly cook eggs was an issue in Metal Gear 4. So I think, like any good and ever developing storytelling system, you know, hopefully ideas are going to be what powers it. You know, not just watching a character go through hard times, but you know, understanding the philosophical ideas and concepts that the game developers are putting forward is a big part of the experience. So I've learned a lot.
Have you ever found yourself challenged to think outside of the game itself? Perhaps reflecting back, you mentioned philosophy a bit. Have you ever had a moment where you stopped and were challenged a bit in your own thinking by a game or the industry itself?
Well, I've certainly been challenged by the industry itself, but that wasn't really philosophical. That was more the nightmarish concept of making deals with large corporations. But have I ever had my thinking challenged by a game? You know, probably. I don't know. My thinking is pretty well developed, considering that I'm a screenwriter and I have to think about things quite a bit. So I've got a fairly concrete understanding of my view of the world and my view as a storyteller. But yeah, sometimes things will come up that surprise me or shock me. I don't know if it was a new idea or not, and this is a bit of a spoiler for The Last of Us, but I was playing The Last of Us, and it's this guy and his little girl, and the little girl gets killed, you know, almost right out of the box after you've just gotten attached to her. And so, you know, from a storytelling perspective, that was pretty shocking and something that I didn't see coming. And then I haven't really gotten too far in the game, but I'm assuming you meet another young girl who you have to then sort of redeem your parenting skills with. And so I thought that was a neat twist on a classic sort of storytelling device.
Now, you mentioned being kind of set in your thought process through the screenwriting approach, and let's go back a little bit before you had a chance to really kind of crystallize and solidify your views. What was an early thought, maybe going back earlier in your life, that was a game changer, something that reshaped the way you looked at the world?
Well, you know, when I first got into the industry, there were certain things that, you know, you say to yourself as a kid, you want to work in entertainment, or you want to work in the movies, or you want to be an actor, or you want to be whatever. And these things seem very impossible to crack. And when I was about 16, I was living in Japan, and some friends, some English-speaking friends, and I were invited to record voices for arcade games that were Japanese but were going to come out in the States. And so, you know, doing something like that suddenly takes you beyond just what you saw as a magic box in the arcade that was made by the gods, and lets you know that these are people that make these things. And you know, it sounds obvious, but it was the same way on the movie X-Men, where I had been an actor up to that point, and I had always felt that the script was sacrosanct, that it was, you know, again, it was handed down from the gods, and you read it and you tried not to mess with it too much. And then on X-Men, we messed with the script so much, and I ended up rewriting that script, you know, for hundreds and hundreds of drafts, that it became a job to me, and a graspable job, a thing that could be done. So, you know, I think the biggest lesson there is not to allow your original impressions to set limitations on you. You know, to say, look, if there's an industry you love, there are people just like you that dreamt of it, got into it, and made it happen. So so that was a pretty positive thing in my life.
Well, it's funny. You mentioned you were in Japan. You grew up in Japan. You've lived in Japan at one point. You've lived in the U.S. You're there now. Mm-hmm. You've lived in Canada. Mm-hmm. Am I missing somewhere?
I lived in Hong Kong
briefly,
and that was pretty amazing. And I mean, I lived in Hawaii briefly, and I've traveled almost everywhere. I haven't been to South America or Antarctica or Africa, but beyond that, I've been all over. And those experiences were very, very instrumental in shaping my worldview.
Well, if you had to choose one place that you were going to spend the rest of your life, where would you pick and why?
You know, it's hard to say, because I love all of those places for different reasons. I would hate to say I was never going to go back to Toronto, for example, because that's my hometown. That's what I love. However, sure, their winter is nigh on inhuman, and I don't think that human beings should really live there for a good 7 months of the year. So I guess if I had to pick, I would probably say California is where my heart lies. This is where I was born. The weather is spectacular. The entertainment industry is here, and I've got a lot of great friends here. But I'd be very sad if I had to pick one place exclusively. I'd get pretty bored.
Well, sorry to bring out that emotion then.
No, not at all. I just, you know, again, as part of my philosophy, I think it's important, if you're going to be a storyteller or an entertainer or whatever, you know, anything that deals with the analysis of the human condition, it's important to travel, and it's important to see cultures that you would never normally see. So, you know, to live in Japan, as I did for 4 years, really changed my perspective on many, many things. But it also illustrates to you where all human beings are the same. You know, whether their culture is totally alien to you or not, you know, you toss a smile at somebody and usually they'll smile back, and there's a common humanity that you discover, which is very important as well.
You know, you mentioned something I really liked when you talked about kind of breaking into the industry and beginning to see some of the work out there as things, you know what, hey, you know, I can do this. What are some of the challenges or struggles that you face, and dare we even go there? Do you face any struggles or challenges today?
Well, life is a struggle. If it was too easy, it wouldn't be interesting. You know, certainly the challenge you face choosing a career path like mine is there's an enormous amount of competition. The people out here are highly trained, super talented, the best of the best, and it can be very frustrating to try to compete with that. And but there's also a massive amount of work. So, you know, there are now 500 television channels, and there's just a need for content. So, you know, the biggest challenge is to realize it can be done and to suffer through the first few years when you're not getting anywhere. You know, we all think as actors we're going to arrive in town and they're going to take one look at us and go, oh, my God, you're astounding. And maybe, you know, that happened to Scarlett Johansson or you know, Tom Cruise. But we're not all that. And so, you know, I went through a good 8 years of relative poverty before I made it. And I look back on that time now and it was great. I had anxiety that I might never make it, but at the same time I was partying in Hollywood and doing auditions and doing small jobs here and there, and it was a great time. So I consider that time well invested. And then the challenge now is building on the things you've already done and not, you know, trying not to feel like you're stepping backwards or repeating yourself or whatever. You know, it's just the nature of trying to stay fresh as an artist.
Well, you certainly have worn many hats. I know you've done everything from directing and producing and acting and voice acting and writing screenplays, et cetera, et cetera. Which would you say has been the most rewarding for you?
Well, in addition to that, I've also done casting, editing, color timing, sound mixing, and I was once the person hired to hang the balloons on an episode of Who's the Boss, because it was a birthday episode for Alyssa Milano, so I don't like to let that credit go unmentioned. What's been the most rewarding? Well, monetarily, the writing has been pretty good, but I love it all. I mean, I look at, you know, I've managed to work on movies with budgets ranging from $150,000 to $150 million, and it's always the same rush. It's always the same feeling of accomplishment, whether it's big or small, and same with acting roles, whether it's something that the whole world is going to see or something you're just doing as a joke video for your friends that'll go on the internet. It's you know, it's all great. So I think the biggest rush itself is the life, and to get to a point, if you can get to a point where you can make your living exclusively by telling stories or doing funny voices or whatever, that is an extremely lucky place to be, and a consummation devoutly to be wished.
So here's the million-dollar question: which one do you think you're best at?
Well, I don't know. I don't know. You know, that's the other thing about being an artist. Sometimes you feel like you're the best at whatever you're doing, and then in the same mental sentence by the end you can convince yourself that you're just horrible and you're just fooling yourself and everybody else. So it's a weird schizophrenic existence, because you have to believe that you're good at it to do it well, but to understand it well you have to be able to see your own flaws. And so so which do I do best? I don't know. I mean, writing, maybe. I think that tortures me the least. You know,
that's a good sign.
Yeah. Well, when I have to act, you know, I love it. I love that job, but I'm always second guessing myself. You know, is this the way it goes? Is that the way it goes? And with writing, and a lot of writers feel that about writing, but with writing, I feel like once I get into a zone, I'm rolling, and it just comes out. And then afterwards, I'll go back and I'll re-edit and find things where I'm like, oh, that's stupid, or why would I write that, or whatever. But you also find these little bits of brilliance that have just sort of spilled out of your brain. You don't know where they've come from. So, you know, whether or not that's what I'm best at, I don't know. I think that's where I'm most confident.
So let me switch gears a bit and ask you this. You mentioned all the great work and all the great opportunity that's out there who's someone that's doing something interesting to you? And this can be as open-ended as you want. It can be in the music world, the acting world, the same space as you, anywhere. What out there is interesting to you right now?
Well, you know, my goal as a filmmaker has always been to get into the big movies, and so I'm very fascinated with the rise of J.J. Abrams and what he's been able to do, because it's been a long time since we've had a Jim Cameron or a Spielberg or somebody who's really come out and just dominated the business in that way. So I'm pretty fascinated with what he's doing, particularly as a personal fanboy of Star Trek and Star Wars, and to see how these things are reworked by a creative artist in the midst of unbelievable pressure. I find that pretty fascinating. And on the voiceover side, you know, I love watching the truly great performers. You know, like I love analyzing Nolan North and his various performances, and Jennifer Hale, who's a good friend of mine. I just watch her and try to figure out how she does what she does. Or Steve Blum. You know, these people are amazing and inspiring to me. So. And because video games are getting so much better and better produced, better written, better executed, it's really fun to watch the acting evolve and become, you know, more and more real or more wild or more creative. All of that stuff I find very fascinating.
Well, let's jump back to the video games real quick. You brought it up, so you mentioned The Last of Us. What's another game or two that you've been playing recently?
Well, right now I'm in the midst of a terrible obsession with Saints Row 4, which is probably not terribly new, but I don't go by what's new. I just sort of figure out what I want to play, and so I'm in the middle of Saints Row, and I really loved Grand Theft Auto 5. I thought that was a really spectacular chapter of that franchise, but Saints Row, you know, speaks to me more because it takes the Grand Theft Auto 5 or the Grand Theft Auto theory of you're sort of a god in this world and just says, no, you are a god in this world and you can do anything, and I think that's really fun. The wild, over the top writing of it. The weapons, the customization, all that stuff I just think is kick-ass. And I just last night got to the part where they did a whole Metal Gear parody. I don't know if you played Saints Row 4, but they there's a part where you go in and suddenly it's stealth action to break this person out. And the woman is like, shoot out the lights and then shoot the guard. And you're like, why don't I just shoot the guard? And she's like, shoot out the light and then shoot the guard. And it makes you do all these stealth things. And then you get cardboard boxes and you have to like crawl through this thing. And everything the guards say is like a parody of what guards would repeat in a Metal Gear game. And it was really, so that one in particular spoke directly to me. And, so that was pretty fun. And beyond that, I like the Assassin's Creed games. I think they're spectacularly beautiful and well-designed, although the gameplay can get a little repetitive, which annoys me. But what else do I like? I've been playing Civilization Revolution 4 for I don't know how many years, and I can't seem to stop doing that. So I really like, you know, I really like strategy games and games that you know, challenge my brain.
That sounds like you've got a full plate there.
Yeah, well, fortunately, I'm a screenwriter. I've got some time, and I've got a lot of gaming systems, so, you know.
Well, very cool, very cool. Anything you want to tell us that you've been up to lately?
Well, I'm writing a miniseries that I'm producing for the Fox people called World War III, and I just turned in the series Bible a couple hours ago, so hopefully we will get the go-ahead on that, although that's a very, very big, expensive project, so we'll see how that comes together. I have a couple of scripts that I am developing either on my own or with friends one to direct at the end of the year, and another couple to produce. What else am I doing? I am occasionally going back to record more planets for my Jedi character in Star Wars The Old Republic. And hopefully I'm about to start recording my part in the game The Long Dark for Hinterland Games up in Canada, which looks pretty amazing.
Very cool. Well, David, it's truly been a pleasure to speak with you today. What's the best way for people to stay connected with all the great work you're doing and follow what you're up to?
Well, the best and possibly only way is my Twitter feed. I'm not on Facebook or anything like that, but I do have a Twitter, which is at David B. Hayter, and I try to keep it extremely fun. If people write to me and have specific questions, if I haven't answered them 4,000 times before, I will very often, you know, direct message the person and try to, you know, make direct contact with them, because I find that really fun. So so the Twitter feed is probably the best way.
Very cool. Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It has been a pleasure. And in signing off, I will just say, Metal Gear.